Back in the day, Idahoans were called fortune seekers because of their willingness to mine the silver and gold in the region. Today, in the Gem State, these Idahoans are trying to mine a 24-carat BCS-busting win and cook the ducks to a crisp. On this distinctively hued field, the Ducks hoping to avoid the Blues. Both teams feeling that this is their moment.
It's time to blow it up, time to lock and load, time to take the field, time to start the show. This is our
started up. Number 14, Boise State, taking on number 16, Oregon. The whack against the Pac-10. Let's talk about the headlines. First of all, Boise State. It's only September the 3rd. They're saying this is the biggest game maybe ever here.
Mark, you are right. And fair or unfair for Boise, this is a playoff game if they expect to play in a BCS bowl game in January. If they win, they're going to be favored the rest of the way in every game to go undefeated. If they lose, based on past history, the BCS talk is over.
They have been nearly unbeatable here at home. Meanwhile, the headline for Oregon, they're thinking about revenge from last year's 37-32 upset loss at home at Autzen Stadium.
Well, when you talk to Oregon's players and coaches, as we did this week, they all say the same thing. They were flat embarrassed last year in Eugene by Boise State. Mark, they all say it to a man. They've waited a whole year for this rematch. And, oh, yeah, by the way, what a setting for Chip Kelly in his first game as Oregon's new head coach.
There he is, the former offensive coordinator, and that Oregon Duck offense has really taken off under his tutelage, especially the last 2 years. And one of the sportsmanship initiatives this year in college football, including this gesture, a handshake, consisting of captains and various other chosen players between the two teams. This in stark contrast to what happened a few moments when both teams came out to warm up a few moments ago. Both teams a little hot under the collar, and coaches from both sides actually had to step in and cool them down a little bit. So on paper, a great thought. In execution, it actually comes out. And let's just sit back and feel the vibe here of college football at Bronco Stadium. Football back in earnest. Oregon receiving the opening kickoff and off to a great start here out over the 42-yard line. It's Thomas Jackson III with a nice kickoff return, and that's where Jeremiah Masoli, the starting quarterback, will take the reins of this Duck offense. Masoli was a great story a season ago. Started off number 5 on the 2-deep depth chart. Ended up as the starter after the 4th game. Ironically, made his first start of the season against this Boise State team. You can check out the starting lineups at the top of your screen. It'll be 1st down and 10 from the 42-yard line for the Ducks. Good starting field position on this, their opening drive of the game. Garrett Blunt, the starting tailback. Soli delivers, and it's complete. At the 37-yard line, Jameer Holland brought down at about the 43. And Bob, let's take a look at the impact players for the Ducks. Who are they?
Yeah, Jeremiah Masoli, the quarterback. I mean, he looks like a fullback, but he is the perfect quarterback for their spread offense. Tailback LeGarrette Blount, unique combination, 240 pounds. And Ed Dixon, the tight end, he'll line up at wide receiver and running back. Could be the number one tight end drafted next year in the country.
Big-time talent. This is LaMichael James, a guy that the coaches, Bob, have raved about. And one of the special formations they plan to use. Nice pickup by James. Chase Baker making the stop. James picking up five on the play. He's a redshirt freshman. 5'9", as you see the defensive alignment by the Broncos at the top of the screen. LeGarrette Blount. Masoli up top and incomplete.
Many times in major college football at this level, if you see a true freshman punter in Jackson Rice and a true freshman snapper in Michael Clay.
First time
either one of these players have been on a college football field right here.
Kyle Wilson standing on his own 10-yard line for Boise State. A true freshman gets off a great punt. Freshman, why not enjoy it?
I'll tell you, this stuff's easy. This is easy, this Pac-10 big-time football. Number one high school punter in the country last year, Jackson Rice.
Tell me he's got it all figured out already, huh? Meanwhile, Kellen Moore is going to start deep in his own territory. The starting quarterback and WAC Freshman of the Year a season ago for Boise State. Completed over 69% of his passes in 08. He has Jeremy Avery behind him about 5 yards deep in his own end zone. First down and 10 for Boise State. Avery tries the left side and picks up about a yard on the play.
The good news, Kellen Moore had 386 yards passing in that game last year.
Second down and 9. The handoff is to Avery again. This time a little bit more success. Out to the 9-yard line. A pickup of 4. Bob, who are the impact players for the Broncos?
Quarterback Kellen Moore. You look at him. He's not big. He's not fast. Doesn't really have a powerful arm. But he is accurate. And he leads this offense. They're going to have to throw the football to win. Austin Pettis, big, tall, lanky receiver, improved his speed. And then at corner, Kyle Wilson, WAC Defensive Player of the Year preseason, but also a great punt returner. Had 3 punts in November last year for touchdowns.
Third down and 5 coming up. Four out of the shotgun, completes it. Take a look at Moore.
You can tell when you watch Kellen Moore, he was coached by his dad in high school. Great mechanics, quick release, very accurate as a thrower.
First down and 10 for Boise State. Young in motion to the top of your screen. Wide open and out to the 27-yard line. That's the tight end, Kyle Eagle.
These are two innovative coaches, Chris Peterson and Chip Kelly.
Some very prolific offenses on the field. First down and 10. Backs lining up out of the eye, and Moore this time under center. Play action. And the pass is complete. Walter Thurman III.
We mentioned last year, Mark, Kellen Moore threw for 386 yards as a redshirt freshman, his first away game in Eugene. The biggest reason, confusion in the secondary from Oregon. Here he faked where he fumbled the ball. Two wide open tight ends on play action. Confusion in Oregon's secondary last year.
Here's the toss into the short side of the field. Jeremy Avery.
You can tell they've been in this system a long time. They execute it flawlessly.
Second down and 8. Moore with some good ball handling. Given time and completes another pass out to the 42-yard line this time.
He changed numbers from number 87 to number 2. Now, he doesn't look like he's burning right there. He is still kind of a possession receiver.
Remember, this is a drive that started on their own 5-yard line right now in Oregon territory. Handed off to Avery, and Avery running between the tackles down to the 38-yard line where Casey Matthews makes the stop. He picked up 3 that time.
Over the last decade in college football, 10 years, Boise State, the highest scoring team in all of college football, averaging 40.5 points a game.
Well, if they get that many points up on the board today, Bob, nobody can say it wasn't against a quality opponent. Pettis in motion to the top of your screen. A little jailbreak screen, incomplete. See what he gets done on third and seven here. Plenty of time again underneath, complete. Nice move down to the 32 by Titus Young, tackled by Eddie Pleasant.
And always in the back of your mind when you play against Chris Peterson, Boise, gimmick, trick kind of plays.
They've got a big reel, don't they? Fourth down and one on the quick snap. First down and then some by Jeremy Avery.
Just about every other play, they've been doing a lot of checking at the line of scrimmage. So they keep the defense off balance. Do a great job with different tempos on when they snap the football.
First down and 10. A very methodical and efficient drive so far by Boise State. Avery on the toss, cuts it back, and is brought down at the 27-yard line by Zach Clark, the 6'2" junior. About the 13th play of this Bronco drive coming up. Pass is complete. Boy, Pettis made a couple of moves to get away from a couple potential tacklers, but was brought down after a one-yard gain. Anyway, the last three quarterbacks at Boise State have all shattered the school's single-season completion record. And the way that Moore started off tonight, he could break his own record. Approaching 7 minutes to go here in the first quarter. Opening drive for the Broncos of the game started at their own five, and a fumble. Moore completes it down to the 2 yard line.
Boy, what a spectacular job. Obviously, the bad shotgun snap. Oregon loses contain, which is one of the worst things you can do. Let that quarterback outside the box.
First and goal. On the toss and another fumble. And they're going to lose a bunch of yards as a result, all the way back to the 12-yard line. DJ Harper now in a tailback. Subs in for Jeremy Avery.
There you see the shifting prior to the snap.
Not sure whether he fumbled a snap, but that time sacked back at the 19-yard line by Kenny Rowe. They've had some real ball handling issues on the last several plays.
And
Bob,
it's interesting because Chris Peterson told us they wanted to do more with Kellen Moore under the center because they feel their running game's a little bit better. But they've already had three fumbles here in this first drive.
Well, this started off as a first and goal from the 2 yard line, and right now back at the 12. Kellen Moore, the quarterback, working out of the shotgun. Pass complete. Rotsman was an All-American as a freshman a couple of seasons ago and slumped somewhat last year. And pushes this one off to the right. Earlier today, just, hey, fly fishing, one of the many great activities that you can do in the Boise, Idaho area. Boise, after that 18-play drive, unable to get the field goal. Zeros on the scoreboard. I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davey. And Bob, this place is so unique when it comes to college football venues. The blue field really had you freaked out, though.
I'll tell you what, Mark, as a coach, you always preach, ignore the outside elements. Doesn't matter what the weather is. Doesn't matter how loud the crowd is, what color the uniforms are. But I was shocked yesterday walking out on this field just how bright that blue is. And, you know, in pregame warm-up down there, these all-blue uniforms of Boise, they really do tie in with this blue turf. I mean, I've seen a lot of teams in green uniforms on green fields, but this blue on the blue turf, that's definitely a shock value for Boise.
And I was disappointed to find out that the myth about birds crashing onto the field really is just that. It's just a myth. Second down and 9 coming up. Garrett Blount in the backfield beside Masoli. Little fumble, and Blount picks it up. And he's going to lose a bunch of yards. Trying to make something out of nothing. and brought down at the 13-yard line.
Well, Mark, there simply is no perspective here in Boise. To everyone in this city, they are looking at it as a one-game playoff for the BCS. You get the sense here in Boise that without a Bronco win, the dream is over before the season even really begins. Last year, the Broncos were 12-1. The community looked at it as a disappointment. Even Coach Peterson, as much as he's trying to downplay the magnitude, knows it's huge, telling me it feels like a bowl game. So tonight, it's two BCS dreamers, just one winner. And hey, it's just the first day of the season.
Isn't that true, Heather? It sounds like a bowl game tonight. This is Blunt.
Now we'll find out about the freshman punter.
They came after him a little bit. Kyle Wilson to field the punt back at the 35. Wilson with a nice straight arm stays on his feet and is pushed out of bounds at the 44-yard line. This time, as opposed to last time, the Broncos with better starting field position. Remember last year, this is a game that had a couple of, well, one ejection on a late hit on Jeremiah Masoli. Emotion certainly running high down in the field. Back with more after this. Broncos and Ducks, and moments ago we talked about the myth of birds crashing on the distinctively blue field. Bob, maybe it's not a myth. The Broncos first down and 10. Last drive, they started at their own 4-yard line. Drive ending in a missed Kyle Blotzman field goal. Avery out to the 47-yard line. Brandon Bear making the stop on the play. He picked up 3. Bob, you had a chance to get a little more info on the turf with one Mr. Phil Knight before the game.
Yeah, I joked with Phil Knight. I said, look, all you do and all Nike does for Oregon football, I'm surprised you didn't put in a blue practice field for Chip Kelly.
And he's
just for this one game. You know what he said?
But
Chip never called.
So it was doable is what you're trying to say.
It would have been done.
Down and 7 for the Broncos. He'll hand it off to Avery. And Avery over midfield at the 50-yard line, picking up another 3-yard line. But Coach Peterson used to be on that Oregon staff for several years. There's a look at Phil Knight on the right. Co-founder of Nike.
So many storylines in this football game. As you mentioned, Chris Peterson, kind of a favorite son in Eugene.
Third down and 4. Well, Avery's had a lot of time to pass tonight, and he drills a rope complete.
Both these programs do such a tremendous job marketing. I mean, those uniforms look pretty conservative right there.
Do you like the stuff on the shoulder? Come on, man, give it up.
I don't really understand it. I guess it ties in with ducks and wings.
It's funky. I love it. Just trying to keep up with the kids, dog. First down and 10. Stopped up at the line of scrimmage.
Offside on the defense, number 39. The 5-yard penalty, and it'll remain first down.
All right, Boise had Ball State with a building job. Davis, their star quarterback, gone to the NFL. Doug Martin on the carry for the Broncos that time. Plenty of football to be played. Chip Kelly making his head coaching debut here at Broncos Stadium. And Moore looking to avoid that sophomore chip.
Yeah, it's Chuck. Tastes like chicken, though.
That looks real good, too, Bob. That looks real good. What are the tailgating activities, Bob? Time of possession dominated by Boise State, but how significant is that?
It's significant when you only have 6 plays in the first quarter, and I promise you, that guy right there is frustrated, Chip Kelly, because Oregon, probably the quickest tempo.
Field, it's a 5-yard penalty, and it'll remain.
In all of college football, Mark, they average about 80 plays a game. Now, to put in perspective, last year they were dead last in the country in time of possession. But they averaged about 80 plays a game. The difference, they only had 6 plays of offense in the first half. And it's hard to be innovative. And this is your first game as head coach. I know how frustrated he is.
He's been head coach for several years before coming to Oregon. Second down and 8, meanwhile, for the Broncos. Deformation and Moore fires another dart complete to the 27-yard line. First down and 10 for the Broncos from the 27 of Oregon. Out of the backfield, complete to Avery. Nice sidestep. Down to the 23-yard line. Boy, Jeremy Avery showing some quicks. Only brought down by, actually, Kenny Rowe missed the tackle. 4-yard pickup on the play. Pleasant finally making the stop for the Ducks.
We look at Oregon's defense. If Oregon is going to challenge USC in the Pac-10 this year, it's going to come down to this defense. I mean, they struggled last year. Gave up 38 points a game in their last three games. They retained Nicky Aliotti, the defensive coordinator. It's going to come down to their defense.
Moore completes another one inside the 10-yard line to Efaw again.
This is a whack conference officiating crew.
The offensive player lined up in the neutral zone. The play should have been shut down. So we've got a false, basically a false start on the offense. We're going to bring the ball back to the previous spot. Mark off 5 yards. Please reset the game clock to 13:50.
Let's see if we can see it. Hard time seeing that right there, but obviously the play should have been whistled dead before the ball was ever snapped.
Now that's a pretty funky formation, right? And you've got Ames lining up where he lined up. Talked about it. A lot of moving parts. This Bronco offense. He's trying to get to the edge and chopped down back at the 30-yard line. A nice open field tackle by T.J. Ward. It is a 2-yard loss on the play. Was the leading tackler for that Duck defense a season ago.
Let me get my offense back out there. You see, Chris Peterson wanted Avery to go north and south right there.
And that's why D.J. Harper is in the game for him right now on third and long. A little bit of heat on it. Incomplete. No flag on the play, and it's fourth down coming up.
He's really struggled from the left hash mark.
And this one is also wide. Kyle Brotzman off to a very inauspicious beginning here in the 2009 season. Not many people would have thought that this would still be 0-0 with 12:47 to go in the first half of play between Oregon and Boise State. Kyle Brotzman now 0-for-2 on the night. 6-for-12 from 40 to 49 yards out in his career. And now we're back on campus, brought to you by the Boogie Sorority Roll. This is the highest ranking that Boise State has had to begin a school season. First down and 10 for Oregon, coming back to the way from their own 30. Jeremiah Masoli, who was knocked out of last year's game, late hit, completes the pass to Jeff Mayo. And now they're going to say he's out of bounds. Here's a look at how it happened last year. Masoli took a hit from Ellis Powers and was knocked out of the game. On that hit, it was a flag.
Make no mistake, Powers from Boise State should have been ejected from that football game. And this year, Mark, he would be ejected because of a bigger emphasis on helmet-to-helmet, hitting above the shoulders contact.
Helmet to helmet hits are now reviewable. Masoli. And this too is going to be ruled now. One official saying incomplete. And yes, this will be incomplete. It took them a while again. Bob, you mentioned it a few moments ago. One of the real distinctive plays of the game last year between these two teams was the hit on Masoli, which knocked him out of the game. A helmet-to-helmet hit now this year, even more in the spotlight.
Yeah, I mean, there's just much more of an emphasis on flagrant, personal foul hits, particularly contact above the shoulders. And interesting, Mike Bellotti is the chairman of the rules committee for the NCAA football.
Masoli wisely throws it away, and that is the third consecutive three and out for the Oregon Ducks offense. You said that time of possession could be a little overrated.
Chip Kelly's goal is three plays a minute, which they almost averaged last year. Three a minute, they have nine in this football game.
Rice, not as good an effort as his previous two.
Well, guys, Boise State's Kyle Brotzman is a man on an island right now after missing two makeable field goals, which is surprising considering how motivated he was. He said he had two reminders that motivated him throughout the offseason. He said nearly every day someone mentions the field goal he missed in the third quarter of the Poinsettia Bowl last year that they lost by 1 point. The other, every chance he gets, Coach Peterson tells Brotzman how important he is to the team's success this year. So you almost get the sense down here, guys, that he's putting too much pressure on himself to meet those expectations.
And Heather, those misses last year and tonight, all from the left hash mark.
Looked like they wanted to run a trick play here with Burrows looking for the throwback.
They wanted the gimmick throwback to the quarterback. How do you defend all the gadgets that you know Chris Peterson has in his toolbox? I mean, it's years of accumulation. Oregon made a cutout, Mark, of about the last 8 years of Boise State football and gadgets and gimmick plays. But I promise you, Nick Aliotti just took a sigh of relief. Man.
That's a big reel. It's a big tape reel. Second and 13. Running a little bit of option, keeps himself and slides across midfield and was hit by T.J. Ward.
And I'll tell you, that was close.
Bob, both coaches have told us there's going to be a bit of a gray area in this rule with helmet-to-helmet contact.
Exactly. Let's watch it again. He did come in with the shoulder, but I'm surprised that the WAC conference officials didn't call that because, as you know, early in the season, when there's a new rule change, particularly on a nationally televised game, those officials like to show the emphasis on that rule change. I'm surprised that wasn't called.
Set a tone for the season. Third down and 9. Moore going up top. And that 2 incomplete and a late flag thrown at the 23-yard line.
It looked like Thomas Jackson had good coverage.
Pass interference on the defense, number 37. The 15-yard penalty for the previous 5. And it's a first down.
Chip Kelly just said, am I ever going to get the football? Let's look at the top. I mean, that is great coverage to that point. And, Mark, anytime you are that close, you should look back to the football. But I didn't see a lot of contact. I promise you, if Thomas Jackson would have looked back, that would not have been caught.
John Avery back in the game. Fly sweep. Titus Young on the carry. Two high-scoring teams the previous year. DJ Harper is the deep back dotting the I, and he takes the toss. Harper into the boundary, and near the first down marker, just over the 24-yard line. Bob, I want to ask you, talk about the lack of scoring so far, and in the previous game before us in South Carolina, North Carolina State, how much of that is a function of just being the first game?
I think this game is unique because Boise has obviously moved the ball enough. Have potentially 14 and heading towards 21 points. The big surprise to the fans watching may be, why is Boise running the football this much? The reason they're running this football is because Oregon's lining up and playing a lot of two deep safeties, and because of the numbers advantage, that's why they're trying to run the football.
Third and 1 for the play action. Sure that it fooled anybody is more under a little bit of heat.
But I think this is a good decision to go for it. They converted the last short yardage.
Going fourth down and short. Moore steps back and finds a seam over that right side of the offensive line, and he picks up a couple of yards, good enough for the first down. Now here's why maybe they went for the fourth down instead of attempting the field goal. Brotzman's first miss was right there from around 27 yards, and that was the second one. And then, boy, you had everybody on the sidelines, Bob, playing psychologist. What do you say to a kicker as a coach at that point?
I don't know.
You had a kicking coach?
I got to tell you. But you know you're going to need him again at some point. So whatever gives a faint hope of getting his confidence back, try to give it to him.
Little hands it off to Harper again. Harper spelling Avery, looking pretty good on that run.
Again, the emphasis by Chris Peterson. With Kellen Moore under center, Moore running game. Pretty good little patient move right there. But you know the biggest reason why Chris Peterson went for it, other than the field goal troubles?
He knows, I thought there was only one.
No, he knows Oregon averages 54 points a game in the last 3 games. Eventually, they're going to get the football.
it off to their third tailback in the ballgame. That's Doug Martin.
You can condition. You can run all the gassers you want. There's nothing like playing the game of football, Mark, as far as in-game shape. So if you're Oregon right now, you are concerned, even though it's 0-0.
Larda in motion, the toss to the boundary side, and Parker breaking one tackle, couldn't get by the second guy. Cowboy Classic is part of Dick's Sporting Goods kickoff week on ESPN Saturday at 7 Eastern.
Did you notice Chip Kelly's eyes right there? Looking at that scoreboard, it's killing him right now, Mark.
Second and nine. More underheated. He took a hit as he delivered the ball. I mentioned earlier, Bob, they weren't able to get much pressure on him that time. Casey Matthews certainly did.
And how about that name? Casey Matthews. His dad, Clay, NFL linebacker. His brother, Clay, a first-round pick by the Green Bay Packers. Casey came to Oregon as a walk-on. And like both of those two we just mentioned, Clay, who played at USC, and Casey, both late-developing players.
Moore has a man wide open. Touchdown. And they're going to run it in for two. Well, maybe the Ducks didn't have that one on their reel of trick plays. Nobody came close to even touching him. It was 7:05 to go in the first half. That is as funky a formation as you are going to see. Walter Thurman and Talmadge Jackson III back to get this kick for Oregon. Walter Thurman III, and he puts it on the ground. Out of bounds at the 30-yard line. Take one more look at what was the key on this touchdown by the Broncos.
This was a great call against man-to-man coverage. They're going to take Titus Young, Austin Pettis, and they're going to run him all the way across the field against man-to-man. And anytime you're in man-to-man with that crossing route, it's almost impossible to cover him. So an excellent play call, extra design. Now, let's look at the extra point. If we freeze it right there, that's a check with me. They have two defensive players with two blockers, so they automatic to it and let Michael Schoke run the ball in.
He wasn't even touched. It's his punt, and he's going to be stopped up. Actually, Masoli kept it himself, was stopped up immediately by J.C. Percy. Picked up 3 yards on the play. Remember, last year, Jeremiah Masoli started off as the number five quarterback on the two deep. And then through a series of injuries to the various quarterbacks, ended up the starter in game four against Boise at home in Oregon. Keeps it himself and fires incomplete for mid-ranked opponents as Boise State played at home in the regular season. Heck of a home record here over the last 10 years. They are 64-2. Ruminate that for a while. Third down and seven. And the pressure coming. Masoli downfield. And out of bounds, intended once again for Mayer. Wilson talked to us yesterday about wanting to high snap. Wilson has 14 members of his family here watching this game. And it's going to be down at the 23-yard. Answer one tonight. The Oregon Ducks. And for more on Oregon, speaking of the Ducks, former head coach is joining Heather Cox down in the sidelines, Mike Belotti.
And it's hard to believe this is the first time in 20 years that Mike Belotti has not been stalking the sidelines as an Oregon football coach. But I've seen you over. You actually just went and talked to Chip Kelly. You almost wanted to unbit your tongue a second ago. How unfamiliar is this new position for you now that the season's kicked off?
It's difficult simply because you want to try to have some input or effect on the game and you can't. So it's a little bit frustrating in that regard. And obviously, Boise State's playing well. We have to do some things different offensively and defensively. But, you know, it's a frustrating situation.
How do you avoid thinking like a football coach 24/7?
I don't think you ever do. I think you always approach things as a coach and from a problem-solving nature.
With your new athletic director hat, with this economic climate, what have been your biggest challenges so far?
Balancing the budget, getting some new coaches, you know, up to speed, looking at a financial model and a plan to take us not just for the next 5 years, but the next 30 years.
A little bit, and I know that your mind is swirling like crazy. What advice would you give this team if you had the chance to talk to them?
Well, you know what? we're down 8 points. It's really, it's just have to play our kind of game. I think we have to run the ball more offensively. And really, you know, the Broncos have probably made a few more mistakes than we just haven't capitalized. So it's just keep your head in the game. You're on the road. So we're in this football game. We just got to come out the second half. And really, I'm not giving up on this half right now. It's just there's a lot of work. We can make some corrections at halftime and be in good shape.
Coach, best of luck to you. Continued success. And guys, X's and O's in his blood forever. Coach, in the
tough to give it up. It's always in the blood, I guess, Bob. You could certainly speak to that. But, you know, Chip Kelly talked to us earlier. It was a pass complete with 5:07 to go. Coach Kelly talked about how surprisingly smooth the succession has been from offensive coordinator to head coach, and Mike Bellotti moving into the athletic director's position.
I really think that it helps that Mike Bellotti took over for Rich Brooks after Rich Brooks went to the Rose Bowl and had great success. So he understands that Chip Kelly has to make changes and has to do things his own way.
Nice tackle on DJ Harper that time. The Oregon defense responding via Spencer Paysinger, who was second in tackles a season ago. There's a look at the first-year athletic director, former head coach of the Oregon Ducks, Mike Bellotti.
And really the first head coach in the Pac-10 to truly commit to the spread offense. You know, he did it with Gary Croton. Gary Croton's now at LSU. Then he brought in Chip Kelly from New Hampshire. So really, the first head coach that far west to go to the new spread offense. Although we haven't seen it tonight. It's been over on the sidelines all night. All we've seen is Oregon's defense.
They're down in six. Moore steps up and fires incomplete on the play. We talk about Chip Kelly, former head coach at New Hampshire, which has also produced Dan Mullen, head coach of the SEC, running backs coach at New Hampshire. Pretty impressive resume. And like you said, Bob, a little bit kind of incongruous when you look at it. He came all the way from the East Coast and got that offensive coordinator's job at Oregon.
It really shows the spread offense is all about X and O's. Doesn't matter if you're in the Yankee Conference at New Hampshire or you're in the Pac-10 going against USC. It's a numbers X and O game. 2 years later, Chip Kelly's the head coach because of that offense.
Grotzman into punt. Gets off a good one that will trickle down inside the 10-yard line. So, sounds like he's winning the fans back at least a little bit. Back at Broncos Stadium in Boise, Idaho. Here's what's happening now. The pass yard's a big story for Boise. That is a mismatch. Coming up in just a few, we'll see what's inside Davy Jones' locker. New feature we've got for this year in college football, and take a look at Oregon's tech heads.
Let's see if we see the true Oregon spread option offense that was number two in the nation last year in rushing.
Blunt on the handoff. That's going to be a safety.
One of the disadvantages of the spread, you go east and west in the running game, and if you give up penetration, Billy Wynn gets himself a tackle for a loss and a safety.
We'll just talk about Wynn being very talented, but also very young. Well, youth served on that play, and LeGarrette Blount tackled in the end zone. And they'll have to kick it off as
well.
This
is an offense, Mark, that averaged 54 points a game, almost 600 yards in their last three games. That's over 60 points against Oregon State, who is a good defensive football team.
At what point do we start talking about this Boise State defense, Bob? They have only two returning starters in their front seven, but yet dominating the game in a sense.
And Boise's defensive coordinator, Justin Wilcox, played at Oregon under Nick Aliotti, Oregon's defensive coordinator.
Rob Beard will kick off from his own 20 for the Ducks. The 16-yard line, that's Titus Young. Young on the move, nice return out to the 42-yard line.
Mark, this may be an NCAA record now. We're going to have to check it in the archives, but two 2-point plays in the first half of a football game. And we mentioned Justin Wilcox, 32 years old. That water tasted a whole lot better.
It sure did. 3:48 to go in the first half of play.
You have Oregon reeling.
You have a bunch of them. Avery back in the ballgame, a tailback for Harper. Avery the starter.
4-5 on your AT&T wireless phone. You can win a trip to the national title game.
Back here, a catch made at the 25-yard line by Austin Pettis, who went up high.
Look at the confusion again by the Oregon defense. They're mentally tired, but this is a reoccurring problem from the Oregon defense. There was confusion there, Mark.
Was a theme like last year. They call pass interference against Walter Thurman.
This is a critical point right here for this Oregon football team, and I mean critical. If they drop down anymore, keep in mind they are an option run oriented offense. It is not a throwing team.
Backs lining up out of the eye, DJ Harper dotting the eye.
But again, to put it into context, this is an Oregon defense that's been on the field the entire first half.
On the toss. Harper again. This time not as many yards. Maybe got two on the play. How fatigued, Bob, do you think that this Oregon defense might be? I mean, when you consider that they've had a lot of time to get in shape with practice and all?
Always in the first game, you worry about conditioning. But I worry more about the mental part of it right now. Oregon came in here after having circled Boise. A year ago when Boise beat them in Eugene, they circled that game. And all of a sudden, it's like the air has come out of the balloon for them. So I think it's going to be really difficult for Oregon to regroup right now. If you ever needed a turnover on defense, right now is the time.
War over the middle. Completes it at about the 20-yard line to his tight end, Ebaugh. It was one of those play fakes that burned Oregon last year. Not this time, as Moore is dragged down behind the line of scrimmage at the 23 by Kenny Rowe.
I bet Oregon calls timeout.
There's a look at Kenny Rowe, who replaces Nick Reed, who's in the NFL right now. A spin move by Kenny Rowe. Had the ball for almost 24 minutes to compare to just 5 for Oregon. Third and 5 coming up for the Broncos. Out of motion and flags down in the field.
False start on the offense, number 66. It's a 5-yard penalty. It'll remain third down.
Thomas Byrd, the culprit that time.
Yeah, Cal Brotzman. The field goal kicker over there is starting to think right now, but how about this?
That's not a typo, right? Zero.
Brotzman, man, he's not giving any eye contact now. There's a bunch of people talking to him, but he's not listening to any of it because it's all on him.
How big is this next field goal attempt that he may get?
Huge. But keep the ball in the middle or on the right hash. Don't end up on that left hash because that left hash is wearing him out.
In the backfield, third down and long. Pass is incomplete.
The pressure on these young college guys. The whole state of Idaho right now is holding their breath as young Grossman attempts this field goal, but it's dead in the middle.
He's 0 for 2 tonight.
Oh, yeah. Let's keep it off that hash.
That one is true.
You know the cool thing about having an O for a symbol? You learn to see endless potential everywhere you go. The University of Oregon.
Oregon, one of the most prolific teams in the country a season ago, has not scored a point with less than a minute to go. It's 13 to nothing. This from a team, including their quarterback, Jeremiah Masuli, who said, quote, I was embarrassed by what happened a year ago when they came in to Autzen Stadium and defeated us. Other players on the Ducks team have said that Boise State is a team that just rubs us the wrong way. Well, for all of the animosity that they seemingly have, not much production so far by the Ducks. The return, Jackson.
Boise gets the football to start the second half.
Oregon averaged almost 42 points a game a season ago. Been a rough night so far for Masuli, their starting quarterback. pass is going to be ruled complete at about the 26-yard line. Kyle Wilson making the stop on Jeff Mayo with 40 seconds to go. Oregon with a couple of timeouts remaining. Soli, incomplete, intended for Mayo, and that's Kyle Wilson, the all-conference selection in the WAC. Waving his finger at the crowd saying, not here.
Unique story. Piscataway, New Jersey, comes all the way out to Boise, and he has a big-time fan club, and there it is.
Hey, that is a nice tricked-out vehicle, isn't it? His brother
look at this.
Painted the RV and drove it from Sacramento, where he lives.
That is unbelievable.
Is there a campaign on for him?
Wow.
False start on the offense. Number 68, the 5-yard penalty, and it'll remain third down.
You think that Madden cruiser gets a lot of attention.
Did we get inside that thing? I don't know. If that's the outside, I can only imagine what the inside looks like.
Or Chris Mortensen when he did his NFL preseason camp tour. They got nothing on that thing.
Third down and eight. Masoli incomplete at the 25-yard line. Would have been short of the first down anyway. Who would have ever thought that Oregon's offense would be so inept? They have 5-3 and outs.
And that shot right there showed it all of Masoli not looking in the eyes of Chip Kelly. But here's how this game started off. Kyle Wilson and Mayo locked up at Oregon with no first downs in the first half. No first downs in the 2009 football season.
Good punt that time by Jackson Rice, the true freshman, airmails it all the way down to the 26-yard line as Kyle Wilson calls for the fair catch with 13 seconds to go. 53 yards on the punt by the true freshman, nothing on the return.
And Chip Kelly will earn his money and find out what it's like to be a head football coach at halftime. Because what he's doing right now, he's thinking, what am I going to tell this football team right now? Do I go in and rip them for this performance? Do I go in and be positive and say things are going to get better? But Mike, he has no experience bank on which to draw from. So how do you approach this at halftime? That'll determine how successful Chip Kelly is.
They talk about the big move. It's just a few feet when you go from offensive coordinator to head coach. What would you do, Bob?
Start over. That first half never happened. We don't have an answer for it. Let's just play the second half, nothing, nothing.
What would Mike Bellotti do? Let's go downstairs to Heather Cox.
Joined by first-year head coach Chip Kelly. And, Coach, you are known as an offensive guru, yet this is very uncharacteristic. No first downs in the first half. What's been your biggest frustration?
No first downs in the first half. You know, 14 yards at halftime. I think our defense is playing well. Our young punter has helped us out a lot. We just got to find a solution here at halftime. Let's see if we can get some points on the board in the second half.
And welcome to head coaching. You are truly being tested. So how do you approach the locker room? Do you rip into them? Are you positive? What do you tell them?
I have all the confidence in the world in these guys. They don't need to be yelled at. We just, as a coaching staff, got to figure something out during the halftime, make some adjustments, and then move the ball. But we're not done yet.
Chip, thanks for your time.
We'll see how Coach Kelly deals with this early crisis.
I mean, that is shocking. The time of possession, obviously, the total yards. What is so impressive to me also is how Boise has run the football. You know, Chris Peterson told us yesterday, more emphasis on the running game. Kellen Moore under center. I kind of winked and thought, I don't know. You're going to come out and throw it every down. But he has been right on with that.
And the Broncos will get the ball to begin the second half. Titus Young with a nice kickoff return out near the 35-yard line. Good field position to start things off for Kellen Moore, a 32-yard kickoff return. And Oregon's vaunted offense has been incompetent so far. Shut down.
No rhythm. no rhythm on offense, and that's why you cannot panic, and he won't if you're Chip Kelly, because you have to get back into a comfort zone. You have to develop some rhythm on your offense. And it all starts right here. Excuse me, Mark. It all starts right here with getting a three and out right here and getting that football back for your offense.
DJ Harper starts the second half at tailback in place of Jeremy Avery for Boise State. On first down and 10, it's going to be Harper between the tackles. Got a nice sign and seam up beyond the 40-yard line, picking up five. Let's take a look at our Home Depot coaching adjustments, Coach.
I think it goes right here to Chip Kelly. And I think having been in that situation, do not panic. You're going to be the head coach at Oregon a long, long time. This isn't an audition. You're not going to lose the job tonight. So do what you do best with that offense. There's a lot of football left. Now, the difference, he had 125 kids looking at him in that locker room, not just the offense.
This pass complete. That's Tyler Shoemaker out of the backfield, picking up four more yards and be a couple yards short of the first down. Remember, we began the night by saying that this was arguably, probably, the most important regular season game ever here at Broncos Stadium. A win for Kellen Moore and the Broncos would propel them pretty much immediately into the BCS picture. That's right, on September the 3rd, because the schedule is set up in such a way that there's a possibility that the Broncos could run the table. Harper in the backfield. And great touch pass by Moore.
Look at this schedule. Keep in mind, they're in the WAC conference. Their biggest challenges will probably come from Fresno State and Nevada. But when you look at the non-conference schedules, Miami of Ohio, Bowling Green, UC Davis, Tulsa, you have to circle that Tulsa game, which I believe is on a Tuesday night.
Harper still at the tailback, gets the carry. Oh, made another sweet move. Harper is in open field. Down near the 10-yard line.
A lot of shocking things tonight. The Boise's ability to run the football. After last year, they couldn't run the ball an inch. They had 30 yards rushing last year in Eugene.
Harper takes a breather. Avery down inside the 10. Inside the 5, first down, Avery. That was T.J. Ward who was shaken up on the last play for the Ducks. But T.J. Ward was the leading tackler a season ago, now being helped off the field. First down and goal for the Broncos. No signal, and he stopped up at the 1 is D.J. Harper.
Look, that was Boise's 56th play of this football game compared to 16 by Oregon. And again, you're talking about a positive downhill north and south run, a whack team.
Defensive line a lot stronger than it was a season ago. Harper still in the game. Moore tries to keep it himself. Got hit right at the goal line. Still no signal. And it appears as if he was stopped up. He got rocked early in that run. A little bit of chatter down to the field. Remember, these are a couple of teams that have expressed animosity for each other. Going back to a season ago when the Broncos upset the Ducks in Oregon.
Again, confusion by Oregon. Scrambling around, trying to get lined up.
E.J. Harper, the deep back dotting the eye. Third and goal. That time he got in. Harper scores it. Here comes another of the strange formations that they use, and this time Choate throws it and it's incomplete.
Before kickoff, there was a huge line to get in, but not to Bronco Stadium, to get into the basketball arena right across the parking lot. For the first time ever, Boise State holding a Bronco game day lounge for all the people that couldn't get into the game. 2,500 screaming fans got free admission, even free popcorn and free soda, all about a football length away from the actual game. This is the next best thing to being there.
It certainly is, Heather, as Barner takes the Oregon kick back out near the 35-yard line. Bob, this is, I'm told by the cab driver, the lady at the front desk, and the guy at the gym, who says this is the biggest thing to hit Boise since Kenny Chesney was here recently.
How big is it for them to play on national television early in the season so all the pollsters can see them? Normally, you don't see them until late when it's already decided.
Got the spotlight to themselves, and this is quarterback Jeremiah Masoli tackled by George Aloka. That is Clay, line judge. 10 minutes to go in the third quarter.
Wow. This crowd senses what a factor they are when they see Masoli go up to about 9 offensive players and have to whisper in their ear what the check is.
Garrett Blunt stopped up behind the line of scrimmage. Sit down while I tell you that Oregon had 5 3-and-outs in the first half. They did not get a first down.
Good wide receiver screen down right now. Just get the ball in a playmaker's hand quick.
Masoli underneath. Blunt and brought down short of the first down right around the 40-yard line, and that'll be Oregon's 6th 3-and-out.
Obviously, there's no spark on this team, and only a player making a play can provide it.
Jackson Rice with another great punt. Wilson calling for the fair catch back at the 15-yard line. And don't forget that, you know, we talked about it already, Davy Jones lockers. It's an idiom, folks, for the bottom of the sea and a resting place for the lost at sea. So every week, Bob and I are going to dig deep into our coffers, bring you something of interest in college football, whether it pertains to the big picture of the sport or something pertinent to that game. And this week, we're going to dig deep and find a couple of interesting nuggets inside Davy Jones' locker. Avery runs it and is stopped up after a gain of about 2 yards. And it's a resting place for things at the bottom of the ocean, okay? So we dug out this week in Davy Jones' locker. Great play on words, by the way. And this week, Bob, I thought about, and what about the quote by LeGarrette Blount? Freedom of speech is protected by the Constitution, but how does it play inside the locker room? This is what LeGarrette Blount of Oregon had to say with regards to a little bit of payback from that upset loss last year. He said, quote, "We owe this team, well, you saw the rest, a blank whooping." Now, you don't need to buy a couple of vowels to figure out what he said exactly, but that's something that usually provides, Bob, some locker room fodder for the opposition. How free, my question to you is freedom of speech. As a coach, how do you deal with a player that says something like that?
This is a great time to talk about this. But I think as a coach, I mean, you have an obligation. It obviously motivates the other team. That goes without saying. But it hurts the player personally. I mean, LeGarrette Blount, first of all, it makes him look bad in the media. That's putting that quote up there. It makes him a target. If it doesn't work out like the way it's going tonight, he becomes the scapegoat. So you learn from experience, it hurts the player individually to do it.
Backside pressure and Moore's pass incomplete.
And let me say one other thing. This might summarize it the best.
Okay.
There's a great quote, and Jack Fitzgerald used to always say this when I coached for him as a young assistant. If you're going to write a check, you better be able to cash it. And so far tonight,
that check's bouncing.
Oh, it's bounced out of the stadium now.
He was the one that was sacked for a safety in the end zone. Although, how would it play? How would that quote play? He might be a prophet of sorts if it was 19-0 for Oregon right now. Maybe not, huh? You're not feeling that, are you? We'll get to Bob Davies, part of Davy Jones' locker, a little bit later. Here's Brotzman with the rugby-style punt. And he gets a great bounce. A huge bounce trickling all the way down inside the 15-yard line.
Mark, that ball's going to come back to the 42-yard line. It hit the Boise player on the helmet right there. Oregon now has, for the first time tonight, a little bit of a pulse because of positive field position.
One more look at the punt. It hit him right on the noggin. That's using your head. Mark Jones, Bob Davy, Heather Cox under the lights here at Bronco Stadium. First and 10 for Oregon. Their best starting field position of the night. And the pass incomplete at the 35-yard line intended for Jeff Mayo. Bob, how important is this drive with 7:15 to go in the third for Oregon?
Right now, I think this is the drive of the football game. I mean, Oregon's defense gave the offense a ray of hope. The ball sitting at the 46-yard line. A huge series right now for this Oregon football team.
Solely complete to Dixon, the tight end, and that is their first down of the ball game with 7:07 to go in the third quarter.
Yeah, that is definitely worth replaying. Ed Dixon, 26 straight starts. This guy benches over 400 pounds, but plays like a wide receiver. And Mark, right now, as bad as it's been, it's only 19-0, and Oregon has the ball at the 39-yard line.
Masoli given time again and finds his target again. That's Jameer Holland.
Keep in mind, Mark, Masoli threw the football at San Francisco City College a lot. He wasn't a runner in junior college. It was another mistake by Oregon. But he has a strong, quick release.
Well, last year, Masoli was voted the newcomer of the year by his teammates after an outstanding season.
On the offense, number 69, the 5-yard penalty.
But, Bob, how does Jeremiah Masoli now avoid, after a great first year at quarterback starting the last few games, how does he avoid the sophomore jinx?
I think that's a great point, because I think what happens sometimes, last year Jeremiah Masoli comes in, no spring football. All he wants to do is play. He just wants to get on the field. He's going to do all the little things. Now, all of a sudden, after the first year, more is expected of him.
Keeps it on the run. Masoli picks up about 3.
And Mark, what I mean by that, all of a sudden last year, he just wanted to play. Where now this year, he thinks he should be more of the team leader. So he spends all summer worried about the leadership aspect. Now he thinks he should throw the football a little more, diversify his game a little bit more. So my point is, you sometimes get away from those little things that allowed you to have a great season as a freshman.
Here he is, Bob, looking at 3rd down and 7. Got to get to the 29 for the first down. Mayo making a great twisting catch. It's the first time, meanwhile, that Jeremiah Masoli has completed 3 in a row. Hands it off this time to LaMichael James, and James gets into space. James down near the 5-yard line, and now the Duck offense starting to generate a little mojo. They pick up 17.
And this was all the talk about the taser position that Chip Kelly implemented in the Oregon offense. And what he does, he takes a converted running back and lines him up as a wide receiver, LaMichael James. And this kid is really fast. But that's one element of the spread we've not seen up until that point.
Slowly hands it off. And LeGarrette Blount stopped up. Right around the 5-yard line. Blount last year, proficient at rushing the ball. There he is, number 9. Set a school record with 17 rushing touchdowns. Sets up a 2nd and goal now for the Ducks.
Blount looks slow to me. He looks slow. They said he wasn't in tip-top shape. Had a foot injury in camp. Had a death in the family where he went back to Florida. He just looks slow.
Had a tumultuous offseason. Masoli keeps it himself. Touchdown, Oregon. Finally on the board.
And that is the quarterback predetermined run, the decide zone. And the Ducks are back in it. I'm curious to see how that Oregon defense reacts on the sidelines, as Oregon is going to go for 2 right here.
Blount, and he gets into the end zone for the 2-point conversion, and it's 19-8. So the Oregon Ducks gaining a little bit of momentum on that last drive.
And Masoli is a guy. We saw it last year in the Holiday Bowl. Watch this run right here by Jeremiah Masoli. Right there, he runs over the defensive back from Oklahoma State. That's his aha moment right there. He is a guy that's capable, Mark, because of his physical style of play, to turn this football team and this football game around. Anytime you have a quarterback that does something like that, that he has the respect of his teammates. That's the guy they have to ride. But we have to give credit. Jeff Mayle comes up with a big catch on that drive. One of those receivers you're talking about. And Jeremiah Masoli's favorite.
A season ago, the Oregon Ducks went 10-3. Martin on the kickoff return. Martin out near the 35-yard line. All right, Reese. DJ Harper in the backfield, dotting the I for Boise State. The Broncos can snatch back some of that momentum.
And Mark, a few more smiles down here on the Oregon sideline, especially for the new Pac-10 commissioner, Larry Scott. Now, you come to the Pac-10 from the Women's Tennis Association. You are the CEO. What's been the biggest difference from working in the pro ranks to now with the college athletes?
Well, the tribal nature of college sports is fantastic. I mean, the passion, the interest that's out there, all the hype that's led up to the season, it's really fantastic. And, you know, college football is doing so well, it's fun to be a part of.
Now, I know you're on the college football tour this weekend. You will go down to the Coliseum, watch USC play San Jose State on Saturday. Now, with all of USC's success and the Pac-10 success, the national perception is a little bit skewed still, especially on the East Coast. How do you plan to change that?
Yeah, well, it's one of the things I noticed coming here. I mean, USC's been the most dominant program in the country the last 7 years. Pac-10 had a 5-0 bowl record last year, but nationally they're not in the narrative in terms of the top conferences necessarily. So I think we've got a big job to do in terms of promoting the conference differently, getting more exposure for some of these great storylines that we've got, because the success on the field is there.
Well, we'll certainly let you enjoy it as we watch this big third down.
All right, thanks a lot, Heather. And the catch made by Young, Titus Young, gets the first down for the Broncos. Offensive coordinator of USC, Steve Sarkisian, up at Washington as their head coach. We'll see them on Saturday as Washington hosts LSU on ESPN. This pass complete. And a fumble. It's loose. And the Ducks got it back.
And we went back to that first series when Oregon had the football. That was the key series in this football game. And now the Oregon defense responds.
Terrell Turner recovered the loose ball for Oregon. Number 45.
Again, an excellent job by Kellen Moore. Right there, Lewis comes in.
Hat right on the ball. First down and 10 as a result for the Ducks. Masoli. Incomplete. It should have been caught.
Before the ball was snapped, number 19 on the outside. False start on the offense. The 5-yard penalty in order to remain first down.
Maybe that's why he was wide open.
Well, you see Jameer Holland, a transfer from USC. He's had some issues, some academic issues, some minor injuries. Really, he'd be the first one to tell you he has underachieved. But man, what a great opportunity right there for Oregon.
Backs it up 5 yards, makes it first and 15. So he picked off.
If you're an offense like Oregon, it needs to get back on rhythm. You had an opportunity in that series to get back on rhythm, which is your spread option attack. I thought they forced it a little bit, throwing the football twice. I mean, he just looked and burned his eyes where he was going to throw it. A little bit of pressure by Billy Wynn up front.
Wynn was the same guy that made the tackle on the safety on Blunt earlier in the game. Good night up front. First and 10 coming back the other way. Jeremy Avery trying to bounce it outside. Instead, tackled at the 26-yard line. It's headache number 47. Second down and 9. Tennis is telling everybody about that pick a few minutes ago. Avery still in the game. Gets the handoff. Scooting between the tackles. Jeremy Avery. That's lined up out of the offside line. Bob under the center. Moore it off to Avery, and Avery short of the first down. Yeah, you thought Coach Peterson was pulling your leg, didn't you?
I did a little bit, particularly after what happened last year. And I don't want to bring it up,
but go ahead anyway.
Here the ball's on the left hash for Bryson. You're ever going to fake one?
That's what they had in mind, Bob Davie. But Oregon didn't sleep on it. They didn't hit the snooze bar that time.
Intentional grounding on the offense. So lost it down at the spot of the foul. First down.
You know what? That wasn't by design. That was a poor snap. We mentioned a true freshman snapper for Boise as well tonight. And right now, if you're Oregon, get back in rhythm. Run the football right here.
Last time the Ducks had the ball, Masoli threw an interception. The arms of Aaron Tevis. 13 seconds to go in the period. Masoli ready to pull the trigger again. Wide open down the middle of the field. It's the tight end David Paulson, the redshirt sophomore, gets a first down deep into Boise State territory at the 32-yard line, a 27-yard gain.
I'll say this. I said run the football, get back in rhythm. But I'll tell you, Jeremiah Masoli has a gun. He can throw the football now.
He delivered that one with some serious intent. Can he atone for the upset loss last year on their home field at Autzen Stadium? We'll find out with 15 minutes to go in what they're calling the biggest game of the year, maybe every year, at Boise State. Oregon snatching back a little bit of momentum in that third quarter of play, but still trailing 19-8. Number 14, Boise State with the lead. And Masoli, the quarterback, keeps it. He put it on the ground. The ball came loose, and the Broncos have recovered.
Again, the taser in motion, the quarterback run off the counter, good spin move. He doesn't tuck the football away. And J.C. Percy knocks that ball out. Mark, I don't care how innovative you are on offense, you have to execute.
Not a great beginning to the final quarter. Masoli. Harper out across the 30 to the 31, picking up.
I thought it was going to be a high-scoring game. It could have been if Boise would have taken advantage of all of their opportunities. They've left a lot of scoring opportunities squander away.
Three on the board in the opening drive of the game, and flags down to the field. And they're saying that maybe Oregon recovered a loose ball fumble. There's also a flag.
There's no flag on the play. It's a beanbag. It's a first down for Oregon.
Wow. I mean, all those scrimmages that you have in the spring. And
Mark, I think that's a legitimate point. But for these two innovative, up-tempo offenses, it's shocking how many mistakes. I don't think anyone saw this coming. This may be reviewed right here.
The previous play is under further review.
Some shocking mistakes by Boise. Let's see if this was a fumble. No question.
I'm not sure what there is to review. They're
really, exactly. That's pretty obvious right there.
Recovery by Oregon, and it's a first down.
They get the ball in room service position at the 31-yard line. Masoli threw an interception last time he touched the ball. Let's see what he does here.
Keep your eyes on number 21, LaMichael James. He's in a two-back set right now in the backfield, right here. But they love this little guy. He's a speed guy.
Masoli keeps it, flag down. Intended for Mail, incomplete, but there's a flag down at the 33-yard line.
This has been a sloppy football game, particularly the last 10 minutes.
And then Masoli threw it right into the arms of Aaron Tevis on that play. Put it on the ground this time. And then a fumble by the Broncos.
Now a holding penalty by Oregon.
I'm going to guess this isn't the way that Chip Kelly printed out his first game and threw it up. High snap. Masoli completes it to mid. Mail gets back some of that yardage down to the 33, brought down by Kyle Wilson.
But you know, as ugly as this is, all that matters at the end is one thing, that W. If Boise can go on and win this football game in December when that final BCS poll comes out, nobody will remember, Mark, how they won it. It's just a win.
Well, a little heat dialed up this time by the Broncos. The pass complete. Mail underneath. About 4 yards short of the first down at the 24. Well, didn't get enough.
apparently stopped up short by about a yard. They're going to spot it at about the 22-yard line. Decision time, perhaps. Oregon Bob, do they go? Do they put three on the board here? Didn't get it.
If you're going to write those checks, you better be able to cash them, Mark Jones.
Eric Blunt was the one that said that we owe them something. Can't pay it yet.
Outstanding facilities here at Boise. My first time here. They've done a tremendous job with this athletic program.
Won the WAC conference 6 of the last 7 years. 12 minutes to go. Moore hands it off. For the Lost at Sea, we dug deep in earlier, talked about the quote by Garrett Morris. And what about your portion of the locker?
I think anytime you come to Boise, everybody wants to know, how would Boise State do if they had to do it every week, if they were in a BCS conference? And just doing some research, I think one statistic against them is just the overall talent.
That's Avery. And what about the talent level?
If you go back and look at the NFL draft, which is really the best gauge of talent, by comparison, Boise State's 2012 drafted, Oregon 34. Look at Ohio State and USC. Now, that may not be a fair comparison showing those two. But my point is, you can win. They've already proven they can beat anybody 1 week of the season. But because of the lack of overall talent, I'm not sure they could do it every week in those BCS conferences, Mark, when depth all of a sudden starts to play a huge issue.
Third down and one coming. And run it well. Harper back upfield, but there's a flag down in the play. So, Bob, getting back to Davy Jones Locker and your point on the draft and the number of players they've had at Boise State, I'm a little disappointed. Are you saying that talent trumps everything all the time?
I mean, obviously, you can out-coach people. I mean, Boise State's made a living out of that. But that's kind of a one-week or maybe even a one-season deal. But if you go back to 2000 and talk about doing it week after week after week, at some point, those numbers of overall talent,
number four, the 10-yard penalty for the
are going to catch up with you.
And replay third down.
Particularly in punt coverage every week, kickoff coverage every week, in overall depth of your football team. So I have tremendous respect for Chris Peterson and what he does. And it's hard to judge. But one point I bring up is just based on that NFL draft, do they have enough overall talent to do it every week?
They've certainly done well by fostering a real family atmosphere here at Boise State. Moore complete. Wide open over the middle. That's Pettis again. And out to midfield at the 50-yard line. Austin Pettis, who worked on his speed during the offseason and used some of it there to pick up 25 yards on the play.
I am so impressed with Kellen Moore. You know, Chris Peterson had to be talked in to recruiting him. He was the Gatorade Player of the Year in Washington. But he's not very big. He's left-handed. He wasn't sure he was going to take him. But the more they watched tape, the more he saw what Kellen Moore's proven right now. This guy's a big-time Division I quarterback.
Put up outstanding numbers last year in this game against Oregon, Watson Stadium of all places. This is Harper across midfield at the 49-yard line. And speaking with Moore a little bit earlier this week, Bob, I asked him what his welcome to college football moment was. He said it was in that game last year against Oregon when he forced a pass, believe it or not, as a redshirt freshman into triple coverage, and somehow his guy came up with the ball. He figured he was all right after that.
He had 386 yards and I think 4 touchdowns in Eugene last year, his first road start.
That pass incomplete. Intended for Mitch Burrows.
Tell you, 2 quarterbacks to keep your eye on. Ryan Mallett, the transfer from Michigan that's at Arkansas, and Robert Griffin.
Pass almost picked off.
Oregon dodged a bullet there now. Watch late coming out on the field. Look how late they are getting lined up. And just keep watching your screen. There he comes. Stop it. There comes the 11th defensive player. Wow. Right there. They dodged a bullet.
Walter Thurman III standing on the 15-yard line for the Ducks. They could use a play in special teams right now. Thurman trying to give it to them, but he's tripped up to the 20-yard line, and there's a couple of flags down on the play. He's
getting a little sloppy in the second half.
It's a game of missed opportunities and poor execution. There's no
way
around that.
During the return, an illegal block in the back above the waist, number 56. It's a 10-yard penalty, and it'll be a first down.
Right there.
Masoli passes, and it's batted down at the line of scrimmage on first down and 10 by Byron Hout, number 94, the converted linebacker that comes up with a play for the Bronco defense. This is really an outstanding and compelling opening weekend of college football, Bob. We have four different top 25 matchups this opening weekend.
Yeah. That's why you have to give these two teams credit for playing. I mean, these are two good teams where you can't mask any mistakes.
Solely completes the pass to the 13-yard line. Let me ask you as a coach, if you're the athletic director too, would you rather take a guarantee game and bring a team in and give them a nice check, or would you rather play another top 25?
I think it depends where you are. If you're Boise State, you need to do this. You need to make a statement with your non-conference schedule. If you're Oregon, I think you schedule a win early to work out the kinks. Now, when two good teams play, mistakes are devastating. If one team's clearly better than the other team, you're going to get away with those mistakes in the first game.
Masoli under duress and fires at the 18-yard line. It's complete. Picked up five, and it's fourth down and two coming up.
You know what? As well as Masoli throws the football, and I give him credit, he has a gun release. But when Oregon throws the ball, they're just like every other offense. There's nothing unique about their offensive package. And they are forced to throw the football. They are an option team that has gotten away from the option in this game for a lot of different reasons.
We get to see another team in the SEC West on Saturday, as we'll jump on a plane tomorrow and head up to Seattle and see Steve Sarkisian in his coaching debut.
Now that's a tough opener. Steve Sarkisian at Washington. You've got the LSU Tigers coming across the country.
There's the freshman again. Jackson Rice. We're back to the 30.
See why he was rated the number one high school punter in the country last year. Shift and motion just about every snap for Boise.
Avery in a tailback. That's the carry.
Always play with a chip on her shoulder. That's something I noticed coming in here. As nice as these facilities are, some of the advantages they have, they always have that chip on her shoulder trying to prove it. So when a Pac-10 team comes in, because a lot of these guys weren't recruited by Pac-10 schools. I mean, it's personal now to play well against those guys.
Fumble, they put it on the ground, and the Ducks recover the loose ball.
I'd like to see that again, too. Was that an incomplete pass? No. I don't think the arm ever started in a forward motion. He just dropped the football. I think they'll review that, or maybe they already have reviewed it.
You'll see some strange things on the opening weekend. Slowly passing, and he almost gave it back to the Broncos.
You'd love to see Big Ed Dixon, the tight end number 83, get his hands on that football.
Michael James in the ball game. He's used as a taser position. Slowly eludes harm's way, and he put his hat down, and that's not a strange move for him. He likes to do that.
He plays like a fullback. Watch him right here. But that's the greatest motivator for your football team. Now, there's obviously a trade-off with your quarterback.
Remember, he was knocked out of the game last year.
Four down territory, obviously, right here for Oregon.
Third and six. Got to get to the 27 for the first down. And Masoli sacked.
You can see that Oregon is not a drop-back passing team. Watch right here, the big offensive tackle try to deal with the speed rush. They are not geared. And Ryan Winterswijk, an excellent defensive player.
Masoli sets up the screen well. And Michael James with the catch. Actually, that's Garner. And Barner's brought down short of the first down, and the Broncos take over on down. Bob, interesting moment a few moments ago on the sideline. What's head coach Chip Kelly telling his quarterback?
Well, you know, he's talking about reads right there in the passing game. But interestingly, Jeremiah Masoli told us on his conference call, the thing he misses about Chip Kelly now that he's the head coach, Chip Kelly doesn't have as much time to sit in that film room and spend the one-on-one time that he did last year.
After all, it's just the fifth game of the season. Extremely important for various reasons for the respective team.
And they have had so many chances to close this football game. They could, because, to be honest, Mark, it shouldn't even be close. It should not even be close.
Missed field goals by Brotzman early. Second and eight. Avery again.
Defense has done. Justin Wilcox, the defensive coordinator, outstanding. And I think that last series was another great example of that. You know, last year, they were third in the nation in scoring defense. They only gave up 12.6 points a game last year. So they are turning into a very well-balanced football program.
It's interesting when you get miscues like the ones that we've seen, Bob, in the second half. First half, there weren't any turnovers at all. But in the second half, we've had five of them. Three by the Broncos and two by Oregon. There's one of them. The interception thrown by Masoli and then the fumble by Masoli on this play. There's another Bronco miscue and the fumble on the snap.
You know, it comes down to, and I mentioned this before, we all know these are highly innovative offenses. Justin Wilcox would tell you he had a lot of sleepless nights over this game. But it does come down to execution in the end.
We're back to pass.
Dangerously so, complete to Austin Pettis.
Went from number 87 to number 2. Watch this catch. That is a great catch, and he kept it from hitting the blue turf.
Instead, it's a nice catch and first down by Pettis. A nice cutback.
And was there ever a game that you can remember in college football that got as much attention and well-deserved as that Fiesta Bowl against Oklahoma? Yeah. That was unbelievable with the gimmick plays, the Ian Johnson proposal at the end. And, you know, you almost get the sense, Mark, at some point, Boise wants to move past that cute story, that gimmick kind of team. You know, and maybe winning tonight, if they can win, winning kind of ugly, winning on defense, that's not all bad. You know, because you do associate them with kind of gimmicks and running up and down the field. They prove they can mix it up and win ugly against the Pac-10.
Here's the safety. Nice play by Wynn. Defense at last year, remember, was one of the top-ranked defenses in the country, somewhat overlooked. They still live that moment around. A lot of the restaurants that we've had a chance to eat at, I saw them playing it on a lot of the big screens and still living that moment, the trick play, the after touchdown proposal to his now wife. Ross working against the Ducks, some hard running by Jeremy Avery. But when it comes to playing at home, boy, this place is a graveyard for visiting teams.
And you know what? Oregon is the highest ranked team to ever come in here. But I know how difficult it has to be for Boise to get teams to come in here.
And now a stinging chorus after that run by Avery for about 3 yards. A stinging chorus showering down on the Ducks players on the field. The chant that we hear so many times in college football of overrated coming from the Boise State faithful.
There's always that conversation, does it hurt the conference because Boise State is so dominant? I don't see that. I mean, USC is dominant in the Pac-10. What hurts the WAC is some of those lower-level Utah State, New Mexico State, and Idaho. That's who needs to pick up the game to make it more competitive and more credible.
Boise State, barring some major turnaround here, in a good position right now. And Bob, if you're Chris Peterson, looking ahead a little bit, you know, there's some still significant games to be played. By the way, this is only September the 3rd.
Blessing in disguise. He wins this football game. If they blow Oregon out, he's got a bunch of big-headed guys that say they have no challenge left. But by winning the football game ugly, they know they have to get better as a football team. He's in a great position to coach this team to be better next week.
This is Harper down to the 33-yard line. And, of course, they get Nevada at home this year. And Chip Kelly consoling Eddie Pleasant there as starting Sam linebacker.
And now the head coaching title is for real.
What makes
it's
you say
for
that?
Real.
Because he's got to face some live fire now. Huh?
No, well, that, but just like at halftime, you walked into a different situation for you for the first time. You're going to walk in there now to a totally, totally embarrassed football team that circled this game for 1 year. And they got really pounded tonight.
I'm not saying the honeymoon's over, but the kind of stuff that they would have hoped for, the run by Harper again, short of the first down with 36 seconds to go. Stayed on the verge of its first game of the season and extending its home regular season winning streak to 50 games. And Kellen Moore, meanwhile, is tonight's wrangler. Five-star player of the game. Redshirt sophomore doing a nice job. As you said, Bob, it wasn't pretty, but it was efficient and in the end effective. Slowly underneath.
You bring up a good point. It's not pretty. It doesn't have to be pretty for Boise. They just beat Oregon. And in December, when that BCS poll comes out, it does not matter how they won.
Once again, our Wrangler five-star player of the game. This is male for Oregon. Down by his shoelaces. That's going to do it. This one is cooked, glazed, and sliced. Ellen Moore, the quarterback leading Boise State.
I don't know why they kept that clock running right there. He had a first down. They kept rolling the clock. They're going to get Boise for coming out late on the field.
The 15-yard penalty on the field. That'll be a first down.
I guess they didn't work on their celebration game yet. Huh?
Well, I noticed they wound that clock when the clock should have been stopped. I mean, they gave out a false signal right there to everybody that the game was over.
They put 3 seconds back on the clock. Glorious, painful night ends appropriately for the Oregon Ducks. Final score 19-8 as the Broncos defeat the Ducks for the second consecutive year. Still a lot of animosity on the field, not between teams, but between teammates.
It all started with Blunt right there. He should be ejected for next week. And about Chip Kelly, he may be ejected longer than that right there.
LeGarrette Blunt nailing Byron Hout right on the chin. We saw Oregon players fighting amongst themselves, too. Blunt nailing Hout. That is unconscionable. Reprehensible behavior. There's no excuse. No excuse for that.
And Mark, think about, we started this football game with a symbolic handshake to start the college football season on good sportsmanship. That is unbelievable right there.
It would come as no surprise if LeGarrette Blunt isn't sanctioned for the next game or ensuing games. And he is still almost out of control right now. And now police and other security have come in to try and calm down LeGarrette Blunt.
the starting tailback for Oregon.
We talk about great marketing for Oregon and how they sell their program in different ways. This is the opposite of that.
This is a young man, remember, that was suspended and kicked out of the first practice of the summer by his head coach for behavioral issues. Coaches had told us in our meetings earlier that LeGarrette Blount had transformed himself into a more mature player.
What happens if you're Oregon, Mark? You can not only lose a game tonight, you can lose your entire season on a display like this tonight.
Here's how it all transpired. Well, that appears to be a little bit of taunting.
Sure.
But it does not
based
deserve.
On his quote that he gave of what he was going to do to Boise.
It looks like coach is trying to take Hout out of the way after saying something obviously to Blount. Heather Cox has Coach Peterson, who is right in the thick of things. Heather?
Coach, congratulations on the win, but certainly a sour way to end it. What was your perspective on what happened after the handshake?
You know, just emotions getting the best of players, and you know, hey, it was a hard-fought game. Really proud of our defense. You know, typical first game, a lot of sloppy football, but I thought our defense rose to the occasion and played great.
Coach, before kick, you certainly had to say all the right things surrounding all the hype, but now that the game's over, now that the Broncos have won, can you measure the importance of this game?
Well, it's just one of 13. It really is. And next week is you know, just as important as this week. We've been saying it all along. We got tremendous respect for Oregon. They're a great program. We're happy that we were able to get this out with a W. But the nice thing is we got so many things to learn from this game. And so it'll be nice to get back to work next week.
After all the hype, I mean, really, for 6 months, we talked about it. People asked about the Oregon game, not about the season. How did you and how did this team not succumb to all that hype?
Yeah, we're proud of those guys. You know, we got some youth, but we got some good maturity to go with it. It's had kind of a bowl game feel for a long time. And, you know, we did what we needed to do, but we got a long way to go.
Coach, congratulations. Enjoy the win. Mark?
All right, Heather. Unfortunately, a night that started with a sportsmanship initiative, shaking hands at midfield prior to the game, ends with this indelible image. LeGarrette Blount. Hearing it from the fans here at Broncos Stadium. And then Scott Frost, one of the Oregon coaches, having to restrain Blount from going after them. This, after Blount struck Byron Hout with a punch to the jaw. And there's Scott Frost, one of the Oregon coaches, holding Blount back. Here's how it all started, right there. He snuck him with a right hand. An inauspicious beginning for head coach Chip Kelly, who has this to deal with now. Coming up next, it's SportsCenter. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Heather Cox, Bob Davey, and our entire production crew, I'm Mark Jones, saying so long, everybody, from Boise, Idaho.
Oregon coaching staff and the security there trying to hold Blount back, and just an ugly ending. Chip Kelly's first game, not what he hoped for on or off the field.
I didn't see it. Mm-hmm. You know, I saw their offensive line coach from Boise did a great job of separating everybody. I grabbed LeGarrette, got him to one of our coaches, and then I was really looking for Pete just to congratulate him after the game. So, you know, I've been asked the question before in the post-game press conference on, you know, we'll review the thing and we'll take appropriate action. But, you know, as I told our players in the locker room, that, you know, we have to learn to play with emotion and not let emotion play with us. And that is not Oregon University. That's not the University of Oregon. That's not the way we play football. And we don't condone any of that.
Have you had a chance to talk one-on-one with LeGarrette Blount since it happened?
No. I've been run through the ringer since this thing ended. So, you know, I'll get a chance to visit with him on the ride home and talk about the situation. And we'll get to the bottom of it.